Y'all got all quiet like I had something to say. Good morning. It's great to see everybody here today. If by any chance there's any of you worshiping with us for the first time, will you please fill out a visitor card that are located in the pew in front of you? I want to cover a few announcements real quick before we get into our worship service. The main number one thing I need you to know is next Sunday we have a single service at 10 o'clock. We have asked the outreach team, went and talked to the fire chief, police chief, and then I wrote a letter to both of them plus the mayor asking for our first responders to come and be part of this worship service. It's just a way of us showing appreciation. And so if you would like, if you think of it this week, if you could just buy a little card of appreciation that we could have a bunch to give to them next week, I think that would be really cool. And then after the service, we're going to ask all of them to get in the line first and have a meal with us. So don't forget that single service next week. And then another thing that Dr. Chip Griffith wants to share with y'all about something we're trying to do too.
It's time to ring those bells. Salvation Army needs us. They have called and said that, you know, things are not quite so good there. They're not toys for the kids. There's not food for the kids. There's a lot of things that Salvation Army provides that we can help with. So we're asking for those, if they will, to commit 1 hour a week to ring the bells at Winn-Dixie. We're going to ring the bells between 1 and 5. So if you will sign up for those, there is a sign-up sheet in the back, and we're just going to have a lot of people that are going to be up there. We're just going to enjoy meeting our neighbors and also doing a great thing for the Salvation Army.
And I signed up, so y'all can know as your pastor I'm going to do it, and I hope a lot of y'all will do that also. Are there any other announcements that need to be made today? Okay. Oh, by the way, when are they making the Thanksgiving baskets? Good. And I made y'all some new flyers. I don't know if you saw them. They're back there. And since we took the thing out about the We Angels, I mentioned a lot of missions projects that y'all do so that as we get new folks, they'll know about our mission projects. Well, let's begin our service with prayer. Father God, as we gather here in your holy place, we ask that by your holy presence, you will make yourself known to us. And Father, help us to set aside those things that will try to distract us. Help us to fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. For it's in his name we pray. Amen.
If you will now stand together with me as we join in singing When We All Get to Heaven, hymn number 701, or the words are up above on the wall.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace in the mansions bright and blue.
Now we'll sing together, "To God Be the Glory," hymn number 98.
Seated. What we're going to do today, after I have a prayer, is I will call out a name of the branch of the service while Sharon plays something. I will ask that when you hear your branch called out, to please stand, say your name, and say what outfit that you were affiliated with, so that we may all properly honor you. And then, also, after the persons have stood, say, for example, an army, and you've told us, if you have a member of your family who is currently serving, because this is Veterans Day, not Memorial Day, but if you have someone who is currently serving that is a friend or relative that you would like to say out their name, please feel free to do so when I make that time available. But first, let us pray together. Father God, we ask that you bless these persons who are about to stand, for they took upon themselves to serve others. They gave of their time, of their bodies, and even their minds in service to defend us. For them, we give thanks. Father, we also pray for those veterans who have served, but because of that service still bear the scars. Some of them came home with injuries that can be seen, while others came home with pain that they alone know. We also pray for the men and women who are currently serving in these perilous and demanding times. We ask that you place a hedge of protection around them, that they might be spared from harm. And we pray for their families, who suffer also because of separation from their loved ones. We ask that you comfort them in your holy and precious way. For we ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Again, if you will hear your branch of service, when I call it out, stand up, say your name and what part you served. The United States Army. Right over here. Jim. Yes, sir. All right. United States, okay. All right. United States Marines, anyone from Marines? Y'all remain standing, if you don't mind. United States Marines, did you go, are you with the Marines? Okay, tell us, brother. All right. Any other Marines? United States Navy. Anyone in the Navy? Did you have a friend in the Navy? All right. The United States Coast Guard, anyone there? And did I say the United States Air Force? All right, Mike. All right, does anyone have a friend that you did not call out? What? I can't. 226 Anyone else? Well, to that, I want to say I salute you. And folks, I would like for us to please give them a standing ovation for their service to our country. Thank you so much. I've always tried to do this ever since I've been a pastor, but I shared with someone. I watched a movie a while back called Pacific. And when I saw that and saw what so many people went through that served our country, I can never, ever thank you enough. Folks, and now we want to take time to remember our saints. We want to remember those persons who were members of this local church and who have passed away in the past 12 months. I will call out their names. And then their family member, friend, or designee will come and light one candle. They will light from the Christ candle to light one of the smaller ones in memory. And there, I will call out their names, and their pictures will be shown on the screen. Later on in the service, you will have an opportunity to call out the names of other saints that you would like to remember as part of the communion service. So these are the persons that have passed away that were members of this church in the past year. Miss Barbara Hodge, December 14th, 2022. Miss Bobby Walden, January 12th, 2023. Miss Gail Chambers, June 10th, 2023. Miss Isla Hooper, July 17th, 2023. And Miss Brenda Lynn Smith, November 6th, 2023. May we pray. Eternal and merciful God, we come before you on this day, a day of joy, but a day of solemn remembrance of these your servants who have passed on before us. And Lord, for the ones that will be named out later, for Father, we give you thanks for the lives they lived in front of us, for the way they molded and shaped the lives of others, for their faithfulness in serving your Son, Jesus Christ. And Father, we pray that each and every one of us will be able to celebrate their life, knowing that they are now securely in the arms of Jesus. For those of us who remain, help us to be faithful and remain strong, that we too may join that great of cloud of witnesses one day together. Father, we continue to pray for the forgiveness of sin and when we do wrong. We pray for your protection, Lord, on our lives and upon the lives of those men and women, as that we mentioned early, that are serving our country. Lord, we pray this morning for peace in our world. Lord, and though we pray for every life that is involved in these great struggles, Father, we continue to lift up Israel, for we know that country is special in your heart. And Father, we pray for our church. We pray, Lord, that you will help us to always and in every way put you first. And Father, today is also our privilege and honor to lift up the names of persons for whom we have the duty, responsibility, and privilege to pray for. And so please hear the prayers of my brothers and sisters at this time. The Ham family. Are there others? Jesus, thank you so much that you hear our prayers and that you know our joys and our pain. And we make this prayer in your precious name. Amen. Let us worship the Lord now by the giving of our tithes and offerings.
We are so thankful and we are blessed to be here in your house together, Lord. I ask that these tithes and offerings be used to provide for this community the way that you see fit, Lord. I hope that everything that we have done for you this week has been pleasing to you, Lord. I pray for this church and the members here, Lord, and continue to pour out your blessings upon us as we will teach others about Jesus. Amen. Do we have the prayer of illumination? Okay, let us join together in reading the prayer of illumination. Since we do not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from your mouth, make us hunger for this heavenly food that it may nourish us today in the ways of eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, the bread of heaven. Amen. Today's scripture reading is from Hebrews 11:1 and 11:33 through 12:2. What is faith? It is the confident assurance that we will hope for is going to happen. It is the evidence of things we cannot yet see. By faith, these people overthrew kingdoms, ruled with justice, and received what God had promised them. They shut the mouths of the lions, quenched the flames of fire, and escaped death by the edge of the sword. Their weakness was turned to strength. They became strong in battle and put whole armies to flight. Women received their loved ones back again from death, but others trusted God and were tortured, preferring to die rather than to turn from God and be free. They placed their hope in the resurrection to a better life. Some were mocked and their backs were cut open with whips. Others were chained in dungeons. Some died by stoning and some were sawed in half. Others were killed with the sword. Some went about in skins of sheep and goats, hungry and oppressed and mistreated. They were too good for this world. They wandered over deserts and mountains, hiding in caves and holes in the ground. All of these people we have mentioned received God's approval because of their faith, yet none of them received all that God had promised. For God had far better things in mind for us that would also benefit them, for they can't receive the prize at the end of the race until we finish the race. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily hinders our progress. And let us run with endurance the race that God has set before us. We do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus, on whom our faith depends from start to finish. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
When you were a kid, who were your heroes? How many of you are old enough to had the Lone Ranger and Tonto as your hero? All right. For me, it was Batman. Now, later on, we had Superman, or Batwoman. Superman, Superwoman. Of course, there's a few in the church who know what I mean, that when early 60s, Captain Kirk and Spock became my heroes. Iron Man and some of those others. But you know, the thing about every one of those heroes is they were fictional. They weren't real, were they? But even now, we have real human heroes. Men and women who gave of their lives to make a difference, to protect our freedoms and our way of life. I say I gave their lives, and what I mean by that is two different ways. Those who literally died in the service of our country, and we normally remember them on Memorial Day, but also those who remember today on Veterans Day, who gave of their time and effort And some of them, when they came home, were never the same. But today we also remember another kind of hero. Christian people who made a difference in the lives of others. Godly parents who shaped the lives of their children. Teachers, pastors, coaches, store managers. Different people in different walks of life, but because they were Christian, they were a special kind of hero. And in the church, we call them saints. Now, I don't know if you didn't know this or not, and I looked it up to be sure. There's a difference between Protestant and Catholicism about sainthood. If you belong to the Catholic Church, you have to be a deceased person, and there's three things that you had to have done, and the church votes to decide whether you really should have received sainthood or not. But in the Protestantism, we define a saint anyone who has accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior and lives for Jesus. But I want you to hear this. They're not a saint of their own doing. Instead, it is a gift of God. Simply because they place faith in Jesus, they are counted righteous before a holy God. And in Hebrews 11, we hear the famous faith chapter of all the saints, of the heroes of the faith. Some, he mentions, if you read through Hebrews 11, people like Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, Sarah and Rahab. But then he talks about some who were more of the New Testament times, those that were tortured for their faith, those that because they believed in Jesus were killed. And so this morning, I want to spend just quickly looking at some of the attributes of a saint according to Hebrews chapter 11 and 12. And as I do this, I want you to think of two questions. Ask yourself, do I have this attribute? And secondly, who in my life has lived out this attribute in front of me? The first one is these saints were people of faith. Hebrews 11 talks about that. And the thing about these saints is none of them were perfect. Abraham lied to save his own hide. David had an adulterous affair. Rahab was a prostitute. Peter was hot-tempered. Paul tried to persecute the church. So they were not perfect, but they became people of faith. They trusted in God even though they couldn't prove that what God promised would happen. And so because they took God at his word, they were counted righteous. In fact, in Hebrews 15:6, it says of Abraham, believed the Lord, and the Lord counted him as righteous. Meaning he wasn't really righteous yet, but God counted him as righteous. And when the writer of Genesis, Moses, said that, it really applies to all of us. That we are counted righteous not because of our works, but because of what God has done for us through Christ Jesus. And when we believe that, we are made righteous. And that makes us aware of the importance of faith. And what is faith? Faith is the confidence of what we hope for and the assurance we don't see. I think of the five ladies that we mentioned today. Some of them I knew a little better than other, but I visited all of them, got to know them all to some degree, and I will say all five of these ladies were people of faith. Also, they were people of trust. Now, you may think I'm kind of splitting hairs there because the word trust and faith almost sound synonymous, but here's where I'm going with that. Sometimes we Christians will trust God with our eternal life, the next life, but we're scared to trust Him for this life. We think if we get sick, oh my gosh, is God going to help me? We think sometimes that, you know, money's tight. How am I going to make it? I need to hang on to every dime I make. I can't help anybody else because I might not have enough in the future. But have you ever thought about what some of these people did in Hebrews 11? Take, for example, Abraham and Sarah. They left behind everything that provided security for them, and they trusted God with their future. Not just their spiritual future, but their physical future. And you know, Jesus encouraged us to do the same. He said, don't worry about clothes and house and food, for the Lord loves you and provide. Instead, seek the Lord first, and He will give you what you need. Folks, are you a person of trust? Do you trust God with your money, with your health, the welfare of your children? And who in your life was or is an example of trust? They were people of action. Have you ever been around someone who bemoans everything? They complain about everything. Well, the Bible is full of people that could have thrown themselves a pity party. But instead, even though their lives were full of hardship and pain, the Scripture said they overthrew kingdoms, ruled with justice, shut the mouths of lions, quenched the flames of fire, and that their weakness was turned into strength. These are people that maybe sometime or another slipped up and did wrong, but rather than wallowing in pity, they repented and got back with it, like King David. Maybe they are like Peter or Paul, that maybe didn't have everything just perfect at the first, but they followed in faith and they became perfected. Maybe they did things in service to Christ rather than just bemoaning their own situation. While there were many, two persons that kind of jump off the page to me because of ministering so closely to them in their hardship was Bobby Walden and Gail Chambers. Miss Bobby was a mover and a shaker, buddy. She could get things done. She didn't let her own tough times stop her. And Miss Gail, I'm going to be talking about her some more in a minute. Folks, are you a person of action? And do you know somebody that's a person of action? And lastly, these people were people of perseverance. It says this, all these people we have mentioned received God's approval because of their faith. Yet none of them received all that God has promised. For God had far better things in mind for us that would also benefit them. For they can't receive the prize until the end of the race when we finish it. Folks, I hear from this that one of the attributes of a saint is when life gets hard, when they lose loved ones, when the world around them seems crazy and you want to give up, when they get sick, when things get tough, when they go through grief, all of those things that would pull us down, yet these persons persevered in their faith. Doesn't mean they didn't try have some times where they may have struggled. When they went to the doctor and the doctor said, but they hung on because they knew death had already been defeated at the cross of Calvary. Then I think about perseverance and hear this. I don't mean that any of the, when I lift up a person, I'm not saying that this one is better than the other four. I'm just saying because of being their pastor and dealing with each one of them in different ways, while all of them were persons of perseverance, and I know that personally, I think for me, the one that was a great witness in my life for perseverance of faith was Gail Chambers. For what she went through, and she told me there was time she would get down, but she didn't give up. And you know what's so cool, folks? Is according to the Bible, in one part of that great cloud of witnesses that is mentioned in Hebrews chapter 2, they are where we want to be. They don't have to wonder. Y'all ever heard that song, I Can Only Imagine, that was out several years ago? I love that song. Well, I don't know why, but the Holy Spirit put it on my mind this morning, and I decided to listen to it, and I watched the video. Did any of y'all ever see the video to I Can Only Imagine? In it, it has the living person, but they're holding a picture of someone they loved. And it finally occurred to me, I often wondered, what are they doing? And then I got to thinking, the Holy Spirit reminded me, as that song is playing, the person holding the picture, all they can do is imagine what heaven is like. But the person whose picture they hold, they already know what it's like. Because they're there. They are the saints that have gone on to glory. And that we need to rejoice, for they, through faith in Jesus, are where we want to be. Amen? And amen. So how do we get there? How do we do what they did? The answer is found in those famous words. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition for sinful men, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. They looked to Jesus. And that's all we got to do. Keep our eyes on Jesus. And one of these days, if Jesus don't come back before then, one of these days, there'll be people gathering this church and there'll be lighting a candle for remembering us, because we have held on to Jesus and we become part of the. And amen. Let's pray together. Father God, we thank you for those that have gone before us. And Father, we just ask that you help us to develop the attributes of a saint, that when we, first of all, that we might bring glory and honor and praise to your name while we're still on earth. But Lord, that we would leave such a legacy behind that people will look at us and say, there's somebody I remember that lived for Jesus. For we ask this in his holy name. Amen. Today we recall that our Lord endured what our Lord endured, that we might become saints through his sacrifice. He gave his body to be crucified and his blood be spilled so that you and I, through faith in him, could move from sinner to saint. But you know, here is another mystery of the Christian faith. We call it Holy Communion. And here's another mystery of the faith. That somehow, some way, we're still in communion with the saints that have gone before us. And that as we take Holy Communion, we're practicing for that day when all the saints of all time will gather at that great banquet table to worship Jesus. Again, today in the part of the communion liturgy, you will have an opportunity to call out the names of your loved ones that have passed away. It'll be on the screen when it is time. But first, please hear this invitation. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin, and seek to live in peace with God and one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Let us pray. We confess to you that we do not always display the attributes of those who belong to you. Join me in this, please. Sometimes, Let's start over. We confess to you that we do not always display the attributes of those who belong to you. Sometimes we doubt and do not trust. At other times, we'd rather whine and complain rather than take action. And many times we're tempted to give up rather than to persevere. Forgive us, we pray. Enable us to live as saints who have gone before us by looking to Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. Amen. Would you now bow your heads, close your eyes, and observe a moment of personal reflection and confession to the Lord as I prepare the Lord's table? Will you pray? Who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ. But Christ suffered and died for us, was raised from the dead and ascended on high for us, and continues to intercede for us. Believe the good news. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. Will you now join me in the great thanksgiving? Your response are the bold in yellow. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the God of Abraham and Sarah, Miriam and Moses, Joshua and Deborah, the God of Ruth and David, the God of the priests and prophets, of Mary and Joseph, the apostles and the martyrs, our mothers and our fathers, and our children to all generations. And so with your people on earth and all the clouds of witnesses that have gone before us, along with the angels of heaven, we proclaim, holy, holy, full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, for this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Father, we ask that you pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and upon these gifts from the field and the vine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world redeemed by his blood. Renew our communion with all your saints, especially those whose names we now lift up to you. Vera Durham.
Anita Hill.
Philip Gibson. Lloyd Cleveland.
Al Brown. Jim Campbell. Michelle Garvey.
Mike Brown. Kenneth Bryan. Alfred Bryan. Alpha Lee Bryan.
Reverend Dan Davis and Lash Myrtle.
John Stewart and Richard Curry.
Larry Lamont.
Are there others?
Jenny Amos. Faye Scruggs. And my cousin, Joanne Miller.
John Crow. Donald Duncan. Farrell Crow.
Pat Holcomb.
Are there any others? And Lord, since we are now surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, strengthen us to run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one into ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. For we ask this in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now, with the confidence of little children, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Because there is one loaf, we who are many are of the one body, the church. The bread which we break, is it not a sharing of the body of Christ given for us? And the cup over which we give thanks, is it not a sharing of the blood of Christ shed for us? Will those that are assisting me with the service please come forward up under the stage area?
Thank you.
I've been here for 7 years, and that's the first time I ever figured out how to let the choir get to actually be part of the communion without having to come down there and back out. So they actually got to be part of it today. Let's pray together. Father God, we thank you for this eternal mystery through which you have been present with us today. Now that we have been fed by your hand this spiritual food, enable us to leave this place and to be a saint in front of the world for someone else. For we ask this in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Please stand and join me in singing Marching to Zion, page 733 in your hymnal. Come we that love the Lord and let our joys be known. Join in a song with sweet accord. Join in a song with sweet accord. And thus around the throne, and thus around the throne, we're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful.
May your whole spirit